The first question is about the Arabic language, and I would like Bara Alouaiz, who is our expert advisor on language and cultural issues, and he is himself from Syria, to answer the question. And the question goes, is alphabet learning in Arabic similar to the Roman alphabet in that letters are learned one by one?
Thank you, that's a good question. Simply, so Arabic language is, the writing system in Arabic language is alphabetical. It's quite similar to the English or Romanic, even Norwegian. The direction of reading and writing is from right to left. This is the main difference, actually. There is close similarity where how we, in the writing way of the letters, between the Arabic letters in the alphabet, almost 22 out of 28 Arabic letters are very similar. We distinguish them from each other by extra dots or strokes. The forms of most letters in Arabic writing system differs depending on their position in the within the word. I mean, initial, middle, or final. And sometimes non-connecting occurrence, like the glottic stop, what we call hamza in Arabic. For example, my name is Bara. This doesn't really, it's not easy for non-Arabic speakers to pronounce the glottic stop. So this is kind of the difference between the Romanic and the Arabic in the basic alphabetical system.
Thank you, Bara. The next question I would like Alf Inge to answer. And the question goes, what steps will you take to ensure that Syrian learners with disabilities will be able to access the smartphone apps?
Yes, regarding this question, we will encourage the ones that want to participate in this competition to have an inclusive design and to think about these issues. And also during the development, we'll have a collaboration with the developers to see if there are ways that we can include this in the design.
Thank you, Alf Inge. I think I'll give you the next question as well.
Okay.
Is there a possibility of making a smartphone-optimized website instead of an app?
Well, we really recommend that you should develop an app. Mainly because this should work offline and you should be able to download an app. It's possible to do things offline with web, but we really recommend the app development. Yes.
Thank you. The last question, it's a tricky one. And I'll, I have Christer Gundersen from the National Digital Learning Arena, who I will ask to answer it. We have a question regarding intellectual property. According to the guidelines, the reuse of content and software, all digital content will be released under Creative Commons Attribution CC BY, which will allow others to reuse, change, and distribute content, including commercially. We were wondering if this was negotiable in any way. As part of the organization we work in, we must comply with the organization's editorial and legal policies and would not be able to produce branded content, which could then be altered by a third party. If this question could be raised at the conference, it would be much appreciated. Christer?
Yeah, it's a complex complex question. You're right about that. So we've defined two licenses, really. One for content and one for technology. Both widely used worldwide for those types of applications. And they represent general direction in which we would like to take the project. They're not carved in stone in any way. And we would like input from you guys on the issues that you see, the problems that you see coming in with your content and your technology and your knowledge. And we are eager to discuss both the business model side of it and the IPR part of it. We can also see that there are possibilities of mixing freely licensed content with proprietarily licensed content. As would be a part of the question. But on this point in particular, we would like written feedback before the 15th of November, because then we can go more into detail on these rather complex issues, really. Yeah.
Thank you. We will now open up for your questions. And after that, we will move outside for refreshments and networking opportunities. For this last Q&A part, I would like to do some alterations to the panel, just because of the questions I anticipate. Actually, maybe, Bara, you could stay up there if you want. And Johan, can you come up? And also Ragnhild? And we would like you to raise your hand and to come up on stage and ask your question and to state your name before you ask your questions. That would be great. And where you come from.
Joseph Noll from the Basic Internet Foundation. Our experience is that if you work with purely offline content, that the interest after a steep learning drops down dramatically. So at one point in time, you would like to refresh. Have you thought about the mechanisms of how to refresh on thin or whatever lines with very, very little amount of data traffic needed? Because in most of the refugee camps, as we saw in the video, you don't really have that broadband mobile network.
I think this question goes to Alf Inge. Yeah.
Okay, we have been thinking about these issues. So that's one of the reasons we want this to work offline. But I agree, to make it interesting and also to be able to update, it should be possible to refresh and use the kind of available connections. But this may be something we also can do together with Orange and other to see ways that how we can solve this problem. But it's still something we were working on.
My recommendation would be to have some recommendation about that upgrading in order to keep the interest up.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes, that's a good point. Thank you.
Please.
Hello. Eric Bolikowski from NorwebWeb. We're based in Tunisia and in Norway. My question relates to the existing devices on which refugees and children can use the app, because once it's done, obviously there's a need for devices for using the app. So my question is twofold. First, what existing devices, what kind of access does children and parents have to existing devices? Is there any research that is done on this? Or will there be any research being done into this? And the second question is, what kind of distribution of devices can be put into place once the app is done? Once you have the app, can we, for example, have a program of distributing tens of thousands of Android devices or other devices to children, perhaps that are preloaded with the app? Thank you.
I think, do you want to answer the first part? And maybe I could try to say something about the latter part.
Yes. Regarding the first question about availability, what kind of devices they have, we have started to do research on that topic. We know that there's a wide availability of smartphones, and from our kind of initial investigation, it seems like it's pretty much Android and iOS devices, but we will look further into that and see if we can come up with more specifics about the devices. But we know there's quite high penetration of actually smartphones by Syrians. Yes.
And I will try to supplement and to follow up on the question. Of course, we already have a project partnership with Orange, which is also providing us with information about availability in the context where they are. We also have discussions with GSMA, which is the umbrella organization for all mobile operators. They are helping us also with information from all the relevant contexts about availability of smartphones and also about the infrastructure situation. So this is a really crucial part of the intelligence that we are gathering. When it comes to the plan for handing out devices, we do not have a plan for handing out devices as part of this project. And that is based on what Alfinga was just saying, that we know that the availability is relatively high. Of course, that does not mean that there could not be programs that draws upon this this learning tool and uses it and also includes handing out devices, but it's not something that we as a project are planning for. Thank you. Let's see, there were many hands. I think there was one there, and then I'll take your question afterwards.
Margaret Sandvik. I have two roles here today. I come from Oslo University College. I'm a professor in literacy, and I also cooperate with a software developer, Grom Design AS, and we have developed Troll I Ord, which is an application. I wonder, this app, is it meant for children who has not gained any competence in literacy? And are the target group, how wide is the target group? Because are they young learners? Are they more advanced learners? Are they in preschool children age? Because if we are going to develop an application, it has to be with a content that appeals to the target group. And dependent on the situation, children may have learned to, well, in a way, they may have gained a basic level of literacy development, but they are not advanced learners. How broad is the target group?
Thank you. I think I can try to answer that question myself. What we have said in the concept note that you can find on the Norad website is children aged 4 to 10. So it's quite broad, but that also means that we do not know enough about the situation of these children. Some of them may have had a little bit of schooling, many of them will have had none. So we have defined it in that way. So it also means that the content relevance needs to take into account that age group 4 to 10. Thanks. Let's see, there was a question there.
My name is Anna Kira. I'm working as a chief experience officer at Making Waves. I'm an anthropologist and a psychologist. And my question has to do with both layers of complexity, but also following the child, because when I read the concept, it seems it's this idea that a child is displaced or one place, but this child is going to be moving both physically in places. And has there been any thoughts about how, in terms of psychosocial adjustment, that it's not just the trauma of the experience that in the past, but the trauma of the things that will happen as this child is in the process of learning? So has this been thought about in terms of, for example, a child who's first in Syria, then goes to a refugee camp, and is this then put into an asyl motak? I'm not sure, but arriving in another country where they haven't been placed yet, and there's all these layers, which means also Arabic and another language. So I wondered how complex one can dive into this, or if you're just looking for the simple piece on Arabic.
That was a complex question. I think I will split the answer between myself and Ragnhild. What we have said is that we are aiming for effects both on Arabic literacy and psychosocial well-being. However, we are still exploring the scope and ambition level. I think it is important for us also to get input about how particularly on the area of psychosocial well-being, how high we should set the bar. Mm-hmm. It's definitely meant as a tool for children who, or households who may be living in many contexts I mean, we showed the video from someone in Hønefoss, it is just an example. And they had started their trip in Aleppo, gone to Libya, lived under difficult conditions there, and now they are in Norway. I think I will also ask Ragnhild to say a little bit, because she is our expert here in Norad on psychosocial well-being and for this project. And I think I would like to challenge her also to say a little bit more about our main considerations so far when it comes to psychosocial well-being.
Okay, thank you. Well, I agree with both of you. That's a complex question, but very relevant. And as Liv Marte also said, that we are still discussing what aspects of psychosocial well-being are most relevant for this project. However, you touch on the core, I think, when you say the adjustment of children in various contexts. We know that some of the children will have gone through extreme hardships and stress, and others perhaps less so, but they will all be faced with some adjustments. And so the psychosocial aspects of the tool should consider the relationship between learning and psychosocial well-being. For example, it's possible that you could address this by looking at the effects of learning on psychosocial well-being, or you could do the other way around, as Barbara Barry mentioned, that psychosocial well-being, psychosocial problems such as sleep problems or concentration problems, sadness, lack of motivation, will affect their ability to learn. Since we don't know yet where to put the bar or what are the aspects that we should focus on, your feedback is important. And if you look at the template for the written feedback, that is stated there as well. Thank you.
Thank you. I think we have a queue of questions here. It's great if you can signal to this gentleman if you want to raise questions so we can try to line you up as good as possible. Please come on stage.
Thank you. My name is Sigbjørn Jung, and I'm working for Save the Children Norway. Thank you. The application in the concept note and what you have said today is that it's for Syrian refugee children. Now, most of the children coming into Europe are not from Syria. There's a lot of other countries which will be more children than those coming from Syria. Many of them also do not have the same educational backgrounds as the refugee children from Syria. And also, many of them are immigrants and they don't have the same rights as the children from Syria. Now, my question is, I see in the concept note that you want to have an application which is easy, adaptable to other languages and children from other countries. But my advice would be to include this from the beginning, to have different languages, also more ages, I would recommend. So it's more an advice than a question. Or maybe a question, would you like to include that from the beginning?
I think... Thank you for some very, very sound advice. We will definitely take it into account. And we also hope that you can, we do hope that you can provide us something in writing. It is correct that we have signaled the potential to use this learning tool also for other languages and other, particularly children affected by crisis and conflict. However, we thought it is very important to start with having one target population defined in order also for you to be able to contextualize and to really focus a bit in how you structure the content. But I agree, in the perfect world, it would be something that would both appeal very directly to Syrian children, but also that could be possible to convert. But we will definitely take that input and hope to get more from Save the Children. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Rana, and I'm coming from Microsoft, Norway. My role is the National Technology Officers. We are more here on behalf of the EduTech and the partners that we have than Microsoft itself. So I first have a general comment on the concept, which I really like and that we would like to endorse somehow. We will probably find a good model about it. But the second is that listening to you guys, I have a couple of questions. First of all, the timeline. For small players, it's very important what timelines you guys have in the process itself. That's the first one. And the second is that, will it actually be like that, that one single application solves it all? Or should you guys think more of actually building the infrastructure, building the concept where you can endorse many players to come in? Because maybe this is not a ball game of small players, maybe it's a ball game of big players. Should you guys build that infrastructure so small players, gamers, communities can actually come in and plug their application into the infrastructure that you guys make, develop? And the third question I have is around the business model. Because small players, gamers, small communities are very dependent on what kind of business model we actually will generate. And also, we all know that from an educational point of view, there are different thresholds. Do you guys think the way that we finance an application and everybody are single individual players doing it? Or do you guys have in mind a more educational concept itself? How to monitor, what success rate does it make? How many do play that? What kind of threshold on the learnings have they achieved? There are so much around edutech which I miss, and I only hear a gaming concept. And I have tons of other questions, but I will not take all the time from my other fellows here. But definitely visibility is really important. And I will encourage my peers around in Microsoft in order to support a concept like this. Thank you.
Well, thank you. I'll start by saying thank you for the endorsement. And thank you for some very tricky follow-up questions. Let's see, can we try to recall them all? I think we'll split
first
them between us.
Timeline first.
Okay, let's start with the timeline. I will do what I promised I would do. I will throw it right back at you because it depends a lot about how much has been developed already and how far you have come. If you, the market, believe that everything in this concept needs to be developed from scratch, it will obviously take longer. However, we do not expect that. We do know that, especially for literacy, we do know that there are quite a few tools out there. But the question is, are they relevant, engaging enough, motivational enough? And then there's the issue of psychosocial well-being and where to set the bar. So I think from our side, we can say that we are going to take the feedback from you and to transform that into a competition model as soon as we can manage. So it won't be, you know, on our part that there is a lag. But at the same time, we are very keen to get the specifications right. And we are very keen to have a process where we actually end up with a tool that has an effect on literacy and psychosocial well-being. We do anticipate that with getting your feedback by November 15th and sitting down as soon as we can, we will be able to launch within relatively short time the competition model, and we'll have to take it from there, I think I have to say. Yep. But a lot will happen in 2016, yep. I think we can say that. Yep. And it depends on you.
Regarding the your second question about not only one application, but maybe more like a framework or something like that. I think we're pretty much at this stage open and also want feedback from you. We have estimated in the, we're talking about 3 to 5 applications as well, which is more like not only one application. And depending on the two different models, we can also do different things. So I think we have not decided, you know, like just one app, and also there's so many areas that we want to cover, so maybe we have to think differently. So we're open to feedback on that one. And the last question was
I think about the market.
Yeah, business model.
The way I see
Yeah.
You guys are the buyer, but there are totally different users. We need to understand, you know, the community needs to understand who are the users and what kind of educational threshold. How can you follow up? How do you design the version of the classroom? Because the main objective is education. Gaming is a tool to reach that educational level. And that dimension, I miss at this point.
Okay, so if I understand you correctly, we will definitely have testing on effects on learning outcomes and psychosocial well-being. And that is something that we are planning for in depth, I would say.
Yeah, we can also add that we're working to have a PhD student actually studying and doing research on this topic. So we're not taking that part lightly.
No.
So that's part of our plan.
Not likely at all.
No.
Ragnhild?
Just one comment that not only are we very keen to see effect on learning and psychosocial well-being, we are very concerned that the intervention shall not cause harm. And we know that all such powerful interventions have the potential to do good and harm. And therefore, it's very important that the risk aspect is also considered so that what is implemented will not cause harm in any way to the individual using it or to others.
But and I will try to fill in terms of the business case, if I understood also the question correctly. What we do know, and it's what Alf Inge was referring to on the why participate field, we do know. We do know the total sum we have available for incentivizing this process. We do know that we have very good opportunities for showcasing the best applications and also those who have made it. And I think this visibility, it should not be underestimated in a very crowded field, actually. And I'm looking at Orange now when it comes to opportunities for visibility. We also have discussions with GSMA about the potential for showcasing the best solutions. And of course, I have Microsoft now saying that it will showcase it, so we'll take you up on that.
I would propose a third model, and that is that building that infrastructure so as many of you as possible can actually stream your application through it. Because at the end, after the test period, it is what usage actually gives the result, where you actually can see a major lift in the educational level, the reading and the literature level, and then you can decide at the next phase who to finance more or not. That is when that will be my take for you guys.
Okay, thank you. I think we'll follow on with the next question. And then
Atle Dyrgo from the Center for Crisis Psychology. You already answered one of the questions regarding the way you follow up with the risks involved. But I know from working in this field, or the psychosocial field, for years, that there are obstacles or barriers to care in the psychosocial field. And I'm sure there's at least 7 different reasons why children can't learn. And I'm wondering, are you planning or do you want to have an application where you sort of screen those where you see that their psychosocial health problems are causing problems for the education? Or would you want an application that gives some, let's say, tools to all children, regardless of their struggling with something that interferes with the education? That's my question.
That is an excellent question. And I would, do you want to comment on that afterwards, Ragnhild? But I would just say that I would love to have input from someone with your experience on what you would recommend in the written feedback on that question, because I think it is a very valid point if you should try to do some preliminary screening first as part of the tool, or if you should have something that appeals as broadly as possible. Ragnhild, do you want to comment?
Yeah, well, that would be my immediate comment as well, that we would like to get your recommendation on that issue. And then secondly, I certainly see the value of screening because that allows for further interventions and also to target those children that would profit most from that particular app. on the other hand, if we start the screening process, it would be because we have something to offer to follow up if we do find children in particular need. So it's a bigger question, but it's a very relevant. Thank you.
Thank you. Please come up.
My name is Morha Faris. I'm representing the Syrian Peace Action Center space, and I am myself Syrian. So my question is, what are the measures or steps that are going to take to make sure that Syrian children are actually included in the early phases of the design process of the app? And also, I mean, I assume that most of the potential participants will not have enough experience or knowledge about what's going on. So how are you going to support that within the early phases of the development project?
Thank you for a good question. First of all, I think I'll try to answer it stepwise. In terms of outreach to also competitors who are not here in Oslo or in Washington, where we will have a similar dialogue conference, this conference is being live streamed and also texted in Arabic. But that is for competitors. In terms of testing, we are definitely planning to have testing that involves the target population. We're designing and doing outreach and assessments on how we will do that right now. And Barah, otherwise, is doing this as part of the project. He's helping us design that. So it's definitely something that we think is crucially important, because I think we really need feedback from potential users as to how this is working. They are the ones that can give the best feedback. So it's definitely a valid point, and it's been taken on board. Thank you.
I wanted just to say two things, because I was listening to Microsoft. I'm a Microsoft alumni. I worked at the global headquarters for 10 years. And I think it's very, very important what the last person just said around involvement, but I want to make it very, very clear. Creating this application that is a brilliant idea can't happen with just involvement at one point. It has to be continuous involvement of the people who we're serving. And so it's the children and their families in all stages, not just in the beginning, not just during testing, but throughout the entire, and that's called co-creation. I missed that word, so that's my feedback, is that this should be people who are used to co-creating throughout an entire process. Otherwise, you will not make a meaningful, relevant, useful, and desirable product.
Thank you. So if I hear you correctly, you're recommending that that should be part of the specifications,
yes,
that there is a co-creation process.
Yes.
Please provide that in writing as well. Thank you. Please.
Morten Tveten, Mediafarm. My question is, will you sort of provide the pedagogical and cultural expertise on learning Arabic children, sort of the cultural challenge? Or will the supplier need to find collaborators to do that? Or will you provide sort of, you know, help us find each other in a process that can help us find the best group of people to work together?
I think definitely that the competitors need to form teams and to have this expertise on board. However, as Alfinge said earlier, we are prepared to offer some R&D expertise in the process, but it will not be, you know, the whole thing. Obviously, then we would be making the application, and we're not. But we are prepared to provide some support, and as is included in the written feedback, we really want you to tell us if you need us to help facilitate partnerships, because we are prepared to help that more actively. So it's important that you mentioned sort of who you are, what you're best at, and where the gaps are in terms of you being able to compete here. So I think that's what we can offer. So please include that in the written feedback, because it's an important point there.
Thank you. Good afternoon, it's a pleasure to be here. My name's Emily Holmes. I'm based in Cambridge, UK, and also a guest professor of clinical psychology at the Karolinska. I think the topic you're raising is really, really important and exciting. And with a clinical hat on, I think we think both about the well-being of people affected by trauma but also the functional consequences. So what my question is, to provide a flat platform to link those two together, is that something this project might include? So that we both think about, as it were, the effects of trauma and functional consequences as a clinician, in this case, would mean the ability to learn. And I think this joined up or interdisciplinary approach would be a question whether we could stimulate that better, because we keep talking about an app, singular, or apps that are competitors. But an interdisciplinary approach might be something extremely new and novel, which is us creating a team of friendly apps that might help both listen to the children, really find out what they enjoy most from gaming, but use that both for the health and well-being and for the education. So it's a complicated question, but how can you encourage real interdisciplinarity, or real co-creation among us, and how can we have a family of apps rather than just talk about this singular app?
Thank you. It's a great comment and also a question, I think. And I think it's one of those questions where I will have to defer to us, considering also the input we get on how we can possibly do this within the limitations we do have. If it's possible financially and practically, and someone gives us good input on what that would look like, we can be convinced of a lot, I think. And personally, I'm a really strong believer in innovation being about cross-sectoral barriers and really transcending these barriers. And it's something we're looking to do with this project in, I would say, in numerous ways. So I would say, maybe, and please send us some input. I don't know if you want to add.
No. So can I have a follow-up just as an example? I suppose one of the things, we know that there's very, very high rates of trauma coming from Syria, and we know that a hallmark symptom after trauma is to have re-experiencing of that event. So that would be something perhaps we know a lot about in the clinical well-being world, but it would be a very interesting subject to try and talk about with games designers and see how there is an optimism to put the two together. Yeah.
So then I would like to say for the networking now, this is Emily, game designers out there, please throw yourself at her, and we really want this to generate new ideas. So that's what we're hoping to achieve. Thank you.
My name is Jürgen from a company called Megapop. What is it about in terms of the cultural relevance, because it's for Syria, but I assume that comes with a legacy of history, characters, specifics for the nation, whereas Arabic in general has all these stories and all these cultures and all, but this is just for Syria, right? Or
that's a good question. Syria is a part of the Arabic community,
yeah.
The Arabic nation, if you want. They share common heritage, common stories, common characters, and we usually refer to a kind of well-known landmarks in our cultural heritage, like Sindbad, Alf Leila Waleila, Ala al-Din, for example. So,
is this possible to find?
It is actually possible.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the second part is in terms of the business model, because in my world, if you launch an app, that's just the beginning. I mean, you have to optimize, data mine, learn, launch new content, new platforms, new devices coming out 6 months later. I mean, it's definitely a cost attached to running an app post-launch or just porting to the various platforms. How is that dealt with during this phase? Because otherwise you launch something and it will just slowly die, to put it like that.
I will let Alfinge answer that one.
Yeah.
Yes, so that's one of the things we really need input, because also based on the two different competition models, we can do different things. So we really need input on how we can do this in a good way. I know a lot of the costs in developments after the release. So that's something we were aware of, but we need input from you guys.
I, Thank you. And I would also like to supplement a thing that it's something we have planned for in the project as part of the PhD component that Alf Inge mentioned, that we're planning for a long-term support structure, at least for maintenance and further iterations and to keep it alive. But how that will be shared, and you have to correct me now because I'm a political scientist, so how this will be shared between the actual company or team developing the app and NTNU, the Norwegian University of Technology and Science, and how that responsibility is divided and tasks are shared, that is something that we are still considering. Would that summarize it?
Yeah.
But we are definitely, it's something we will integrate, and we are not making something that we will let slowly die when we have put so much effort into getting all these great people together to work on it. So I think if there are not any other questions, I think we will have networking outside. And I think there are many people who will try to hook up with some of those who have asked brilliant questions. And we will also be there. And thank you. Please send your written input by November 15th and stay engaged. And I hope we will have many competitors for this innovation challenge. Thank you.